Hi everyone. In this video, we'll discuss how to perform confirmatory factor analysis or CFA model using AMOS. We will use the diagram we created in the previous video, which has 22 observed variables and 3 latent variables. I would like to emphasize that confirmatory factor analysis is different from exploratory factor analysis. Confirmatory factor analysis is a theory-driven method, and the factor structure is constructed based on a ground theory and literature review. In other words, you propose a factor structure with latent and observed variables and have theoretical support for your factor structure. Then you use the data to confirm this proposed factor structure. On the other hand, exploratory factor analysis is a data-driven method. In other words, it is exploratory in its nature, and the factor structure is derived from the data. This method is usually used to create a new factor structure based on data. The factor analysis will show us the underlying factors and corresponding items, and we can examine each factor and give it an appropriate name. This method has been covered in DAV 726. So we have this path diagram for the CFA model. We will run this analysis to test the model. Note that an important requirement for testing a model in AMOS is to have completed data. In other words, if a data has missing values, they must be detected and handled properly. Before running the model, we need to set some properties. On the left panel, we select Analysis Properties. Under Estimation tab, we'll select Maximum Likelihood. This button is checked by default. Make sure to not check Estimate Means and Intercept. Checking this box will not give you sufficient model fit indices to evaluate the model. If your data has missing values, AMOS will give an error message saying that you need to check this box to be able to run the model. Don't do that. If you see that message, you need to double check your data and handle all missing values and run the model again. Under Output tab, we select Standardized Estimates, which will give us standardized regression weights. Then we select Modification Indices, which are important for us in the post-hoc analysis. Finally, we select Test for Normality and Outliers. This would help us test the normality assumption and check the outliers. Now we can run our model. On the left panel, we click on Calculate Estimates button, which will run the model based on the path diagram we created using the data set that is linked to this diagram. Up here, we have two diagrams. The left one shows us the original diagram, and the right one shows us the diagram with results. Specifically, we will see our diagram with the regression weights, correlation values of covariance, and variance of error terms. But we will use the complete outputs in text, which shows more detailed results. On the left panel, we select View Text, and AMOS will open the full output text. The text will show us a lot of information. We see the analysis summary, variable summary, parameter summary, etc. Notes for model show us the degree of freedom and chi-square for the entire model. First, we'll look at assessment for normality. Note that normality is an important assumption for structural equation modeling method. The output shows us both skew and kurtosis values. For structural equation modeling, kurtosis values tend to have more effect on the model, so we'll examine it more carefully. With AMOS, kurtosis values of 0 mean perfect normality. Typically, kurtosis values less than 3 are considered acceptable. Byrne, 2010, also states that kurtosis of less than 5 is still acceptable. In this case, we see one item with kurtosis greater than 3 and one with kurtosis greater than 5. Since the kurtosis values are not very high, we do not need to transform these variables. Nonetheless, in reality, I would recommend examining the histogram of these variables. In some cases, where the cutoff values are too high, we may need to transform variables to ensure the model fit. You can also run two models, with and without transformation, and compare the results. The next output we need to look at is outliers using Mahalanobis D-square. These are the outliers detected by AMOS. We also need to decide whether we should delete these cases. Burn suggests that we do not delete all cases with outliers, which will result in losing information. Instead, we should look at cases with standout D-square values. In this case, we see two cases, 115 and 1061, with the D-square values greater than 100, and we may need to delete these cases. In this example, we'll keep them and see how the model fit looks like. Next, we'll look at estimates, which will show us the regression weights in the model, also called factor loadings. We have unstandardized and standardized factor loadings. We'll get back to this after we evaluate the model fit. Typically, we prefer factor loadings greater than 0.7 or at least greater than 0.5, but we cannot make conclusions about factor loadings until we achieve acceptable model fit. We'll click on model fit to evaluate how the theoretical model fits to the data. There are a lot of model fit indices provided by AMOS. Burns provides details of them. I would recommend focusing on following indices: CFI, GFI, AGFI, NFI, CMIN divided by DF, and RMSEA. The rule of thumb is that to ensure good model fit, we expect CFI greater than 0.93, GFI, AGFI, and NFI should be greater than 0.9. CMIN divided by DF should be less than or equal to 3, and RMSEA should be less than 0.06. In this case, we do not have good model fit. CFI, GFI, AGFI, and NFI are all less than 0.9. CMIN divided by DF is greater than 10, and RMSEA is greater than 0.06. Due to the poor model fit, the post-hoc analysis is required. The reason is that if good model fit is not achieved, the results are not conclusive. The post-hoc analysis, also called model respecifications, is a process of re-evaluating the model and making necessary modifications to the model to achieve good model fit. To perform post-hoc analysis, we need to look at modification indices. There is no clear cut-off number that we should use to decide which item needs to be revised. We need to identify a standout value from others. In this process, we will only examine the suggested covariance between two error terms or suggested regression weight between an item and a factor, also called cross-loading. Other relationships are not meaningful in this process, such as covariance between an error term and an item, or between an error term and a factor. We will screen through these numbers and focus on the highest numbers. So we see some suggested covariance over 100, over 300, and another one with 276. The rule of thumb is that we make only one change to the model at a time, because a change in the model will change the model fit and MI values. In this case, the highest MI value is 303 for covariance between two error terms, E2 and E1. We will covariate these error terms in the model to see if the model fit will improve. To do that, we go back to the original model. Then we use the double arrow to add a covariance between E1 and E2. Then we run the model again. The model is run and we'll look at the text outputs. Let's look at the model fit. We can see that the model fit improves a little bit. CFI now is 0.866 compared to 0.83 before, but the model fit is still not satisfactory. So we examine modification indices again. We see a high MI value of 215, but this is between an error term and a factor, so we will disregard it. Another high MI value of 265 is between two error terms. As we screen through the entire MI values, this is the highest value that is meaningful, indicating covariance between E6 and E16. We go back to the model and add this covariance. Again, we make one change at a time. So we add a covariance between E16 and E6 using a double arrow and run the model. Here is the text output, and we will examine the model fit. We can see that CFI now is 0.889, an improvement from 0.866. And RMSEA is 0.007, also showing improvement. And we continue to examine modification indices. We find a high MI value of 177 for the loading between item 12 and factor 1. This is a cross-loading situation. Let's look at the model. Currently, item 12 is loading to F3. And the MI value suggests a cross-loading from item 12 to F1. So we add an arrow from F1 to item 12, and we run the model again. We look at the model fit in the output. GFI is 0.912, CFI is 0.908, showing good improvement. RMSEA is 0.064, also showing improvement. We are getting close. We examine MI values again. We notice a high MI value of 100, which is a covariance between E15 and E5. And we will make this change to the model by adding a double arrow between E15 and E5. If you compare this example with the example in the textbook, you'll see some differences. The reason is that the model in the book uses a much smaller sample size. Let's run the model again. The model fit gets much better. CFI now is 0.917, GFI is 0.921, AGFI is 0.901, and RMSEA is 0.0061. Cmin divided by DF is still greater than 3. We can continue the same process until we achieve satisfactory model fit. For the purpose of this example, I will stop here and consider this model fit not great, but acceptable. I have an important note about this respecification process. It is an exploratory process to respecify the model to find the model best fits the data. While it is an important step, we should not overdo it, since it may lead to a very messy CFA model. It may also raise questions about manipulating the model to fit the data. We should use literature as the guide in this process. As I mentioned before, we should only make one change at a time and review the revised model to see if it makes sense before making the next change. Nonetheless, there's one important benefit of doing this. We can identify the problematic items with high measurement errors or cross-factor loadings. For example, after multiple model specifications, we notice an item with multiple covariance errors with other items, especially the items in another construct. Then we know this item is questionable. We might have to reword or revise the item or even delete it. This process is particularly helpful in a pilot study when you try to validate our measurement instrument. By identifying problematic items and making corrections, we can have a better fit model with the full survey data. I want to also show you a case that we might need to delete an item from the model. For example, we have a cross-loading item, item 12, which loads to two different factors, F1 and F3, which could be problematic. Since CFA is a theory-driven method to decide what to do with this item, you need to go back to the ground theory and literature review to see if it makes sense to delete or keep this item. For example, after consideration, you decide to remove the item from the analysis. To do so in AMOS, we click Erase Objects on the left, and then click on item 12 and its error term E12. The item and its error term are deleted from the model. Then run the model again. In this case, the new model has very similar model fit indices. That is how to perform confirmatory factor analysis using AMOS. Thank you, and bye now.